honor to introduce our first speaker this morning, who is my great collaborator and friend, Henri Moscovici from Ohio State University. And he will talk about the local index formula in noncommutative geometry and Hopf-cyclic. Okay, Henri, this is yours.
All right, thank you very, very much. So indeed, I'll talk about the local index formula and about Hopf-cyclic cohomology. And let me just put the abstract as an outline and repeat what I said, that I'm going to survey these two topics, which were developed in a series of joint works with Alain, in which cyclic cohomology played a key role. So first, I recall this local index formula for spectral triples with discrete, let's say, zeta dimension spectrum, which I've defined, and which is an extension of the Atiyah-Singer local index theorem to non-commutative spaces. Then I will sketch its application to the geometry of the leaf spaces of foliations, which led us to find this variant of cyclic cohomology, which is Hopf-cyclic cohomology, the cyclic cohomology adapted to Hopf algebras. And finally, I would like to have time, hopefully, to illustrate that this Hopf-cyclic cohomology is a sort of universal repository for characteristic classes, not only of foliations, but of some other non-commutative spaces. So characteristic classes of foliations are known in various guises. This is one which is more flexible and can be adapted to other spaces which don't have such a fine structure like the one required for the classical theory of the characteristic classes. Okay, so let's start by recalling Kant's definition of the Chern character. So Alain talked yesterday about quantized calculus and how this idea led him to develop cyclic cohomology, and in particular, the Chern character from K-homology to cyclic cohomology. So the setting, which is now well known, is that of description of the K-homology in terms of what Atiyah suggested early on, namely in terms of abstract versions of elliptic operators, which are called Fredholm modules, over algebras, and which have developed into very effective theory for C-star algebras, for instance, and not just for ordinary spaces, the Brown, Douglas, Fillmore, and then Kasparov's work and so on, showed how powerful that idea was. But what was missing, as Alain also mentioned, was an effective tool for computing with such objects and getting out some numbers out of them, not just classes and functorial manipulations, which are, of course, very good. But sometimes you need more than that. And that's why he was led to develop cyclic cohomology. And it all started, as he explained, from sort of down-to-earth ways of computing indices of this kind of abstract elliptic operators. So there are these two flavors the even case in which the Fresnel module comes in doubt, not only with what I wrote here on the first line. I mean, A is an algebra, F is an operator on a Hilbert space on which the algebra acts by bounded operators. But if you have a grading and F anti-commutes with that grading, then you are in the even case. And so you can define the pairing of the class represented of the cycle, if you want, over the algebra represented by this Fresnel module, and which would be like representing a cohomology class with a k-theory class of an idempotent, self-adjoint idempotent, say, and the index of this compression gives you this pairing, which can be computed by mimicking the basic computations with the parametrics for elliptic operators. It can be computed by this trace and involving sufficiently many commutators so that the requirement, which was the axiom that the commutators are in a certain Schatten class, the number of commutators is sufficient to ensure that this makes sense, this formula makes sense. And there is also a similar formula in the odd case. In the odd case, of course, you take an invertible element of the algebra, and then you can compress it by the projection onto the half of the spectrum of this F. Oh, sorry, I'm in the odd case now. In the odd case, yes. Right here, it's formula for the odd case. In the odd case, you compress it by P, this idempotent one, as I said, this part of the spectrum in which F is identity. And you get the index formula for this other Fresnel operator. And so if you look at these two formulas, you see that they in fact come from a polarized version, multilinear version, in which you take an expression of this sort. And this is a cyclic co-cycle, in fact, as Alain, in fact, sketched yesterday. And that defines the Chern character in K-homology for, of course, the classes of K-homology, which can be represented by this kind of p-summable Fresnel modules. And it was like, you know, in the typical Alain style, in his paper, after he gave this definition, he immediately came up with several striking examples of how it applies. The first one being that he reproved the theorem of Pimsner and Voiculescu about the Kadisant, the formerly Kadisant conjecture for the C-star algebra of the free group with two generators, by showing that, in fact, the canonical trace is the Chern character of a Fresnel module. And the Fresnel module can be constructed from the tree associated to the free group. That was beautiful. And then he gave some other examples in that paper. By the way, it's quoted as the 1985 paper, but it was preprint, IEGS preprint in 1982, and it was so unconventional that the mostly conventional mathematical establishment took 3 years to publish it. So this, let me go back to this formula. Although he gave those striking examples, it's clear that if you want to bridge the gap between so the very non-commutative spaces and the usual commutative spaces, computing a trace by directly by such a formula it's very difficult. And so there was a need to find a more flexible way in which to represent these K-cycles, K-homology, so that one can come up with a formula which is more computable, like the local formula in the case of manifolds. And of course, the classical paradigm for that is the case of the Dirac operator on a manifold, or in fact, any kind of geometric elliptic operator on the manifold. And the benefit of that is that it will also give, I mean, a more flexible notion in which modeled after the Dirac would also give you a handle on the metric structure for a non-commutative space. Because again, as Alain mentioned yesterday, Dirac is like the inverse line element in the classical case, so in physics too. So it's natural to expect that something model on the Dirac would give an analog of a metric structure on a non-commutative space. And anyway, this refinement of Alain is that instead of just taking the Fredholm module given by F, which is like the analog, say, of a pseudo differential operator of order zero, you take the analog of a differential operator. Well, you can't say what differential is, but at least it should be unbounded, self-adjoint. And then you require it to be like a first order by asking that the commutators with the elements of the algebra are bounded. Now, you also require this finite dimensionality of the space by imposing the condition that the inverse of is Laplacian or something to make it invertible, square root of the Laplacian, has a certain modified Schatten class, which gives the dimension of the space as a finite number, P. So that's these three requirements are the absolutely basic requirements for the notion of spectral triple, the minimal requirements. Of course, the underlying Fredholm module is obtained by taking the sine of D, which means D divided by the absolute value of D. And you can make it, if D is not invertible, you can modify a little bit the cycle and make it so that this makes sense. Or you can take, like in Golian's talk yesterday, D divided by square root of D squared plus one, and also modify the cycle a little bit. So there is again a graded case and the ungraded case. Now, this notion is already a refinement of the Fredholm cycle notion, but to localize the Chern character requires another wrinkle of refinement, which should allow to pass to something like a semi-classical limit. Again, as I said, the case of the elliptic differential operators on a manifold, this is the model which guides this kind of development. And now, how do you pass to some sort of localization? Well, you have to use the analog of pseudo differential calculus. And having a Fredholm module gives you the basic notions to develop such a pseudo differential calculus. Because assuming that you have such a spectral triple, there is a natural Sobolev scale. Since you take the Sobolev S space as being the domain of absolute of D to the power S. And then you have all the scale, including H infinity and its dual. And then you have, you can define a class of operators. This is a rough sort of class in which the order is defined by how it moves these Sobolev spaces. And of course, you need to add more assumptions to the basic ones of the spectral triple to be able to develop pseudo-differential calculus. So one of these assumptions is that not only the elements of the algebra, but also their commutators with D are in the domain of all the powers of this derivation, the adjoint action, the commutator with the absolute value of D. Of course, this all happens into a subalgebra, if you want, of a sister algebra, because this script A is not a sister algebra, but it's a dense subalgebra, which you want to show that has the same K theory and K homology in the sense that, well, it's closed under holomorphic functional calculus, for instance. So the script notation is for this smoothing of parts of the smooth parts of a sister algebra, which underlies the whole construction. And then you define an order filtration after you have this derivation, which is for operators, which is given by this interaction with the domains of the little delta. So this defines, again, a subalgebra of analogs of pseudo-differential operators of order S. Now, in all of this, when I put negative powers, I assume that I'm working with the absolute value restricted of D, restricted to the part where it's invertible, of course, D. I mean, you throw out the kernel. Okay, so then there is an algebra which is more like differential operators, and that's the algebra generated by operators which are, you start from the algebra A, which is viewed as functions, analogs of functions, and then you take commutators with D, and then you take further commutators with D square, and this is denoted by nabla here. And it's filtered by the powers of this nabla. So that would be the algebra, the analog of differential operators. Finally, one needs a notation for another algebra, which is generated by taking powers of little delta, which is a commutator with absolute of D. And they generate an algebra because of this relation, which is written underneath. Alpha is a complex number here. So in these expansions, by the way, this notation means that the remainder, if you stop at order n, the remainder is in op of order negative n, like in the usual pseudo-differential calculus. So you have a filtration, you have the scale, you have a filtration, you have the abstract, basic abstract setting for a pseudo-differential calculus. Now, the new essential assumption, so far, these were things which were more or less understandable. But now, there is a more stringent assumption which is needed for this localization of the Chern character, which is expressed here as the zeta dimension spectrum assumption. So this assumption amounts to saying that outside of a discrete set, the zeta functions, which you can form out of this pseudo-differential operators, abstract pseudo-differential operators, they extend holomorphically. So the outside this discrete set. So the singularities are only on this set. Also, you need an overall bound for all the order of the singularities. But okay, so once you have this, then indeed you are in good shape to work with this pseudo-differential calculus and obtain a localization of the Chern character, Kohn's Chern character formula. By the way, so we don't need to assume that the poles are simple, but because you can work with the residues for higher order poles. Of course, you take the residue of appropriate residue of the zeta function. There is a relation between these higher residues applied to commutators, which I skipped, which shows you in particular that the zero residue, which is the ordinary residue, which works for means that the pole is simple, is a trace. So among all these higher residues, there are cohomological relations, but in particular for the zero, for the simple poles, you do get a trace. All right, so this is about the pseudo-differential calculus, which allows you to then formulate local form of the Chern character by writing the components of not cyclic, but co-cycle in the little b capital B complex of cyclic homology for the given algebra by this formula, which looks a little bit scary. So in this formula, you see there is a sum of residues, of higher residues, in fact, possibly higher residues of zeta functions applied to these expressions, which are commutators of the elements in the algebra with D and its square, with D and D square. So, and you also have this strange coefficient. Well, not so strange, in characteristic classes, you always have coefficients of this form, but you don't have derivatives of the gamma function, usually. So the statement is, I just put the statement in the odd case, because it's easier to write, a little bit easier. And the statement is that the cohomology, that what I wrote here is a co-cycle in the little b capital B complex. This, of course, statement here also implies that everything makes sense, which means that these sums are finite, in fact, because it's clear that after a while, when the order is sufficiently low, since we are taking here the residue of a zeta function of a pseudo-differential operator of more and more negative order because of the negative powers of D, of the absolute value of D, then the residues are zero. So all these sums are finite. The co-cycle has only finitely many non-zero terms. And so you do get something which makes complete sense. And the statement is that you get the Chern character in K-homology as the class is the same as the one defined by the phase of the operator. So the formula, as I said, looks a little bit forbidding, but when all the poles are simple, which happens in many cases, then you only have a trace here, which extends the Wozniacki residue to this kind of pseudo-differential calculus. Now, yesterday, Boris Tsigan showed us that there is an algebraic way of passing from the J-loco cycle to some expression. If you look at the right-hand side of what I wrote here, he had, and eliminate the heat kernel, he had something like that on the board. That's exactly what we used, in fact, implicitly to prove this theorem, namely the J-loco cycle can be rescaled. So I put here T in front of B squared, but I didn't put the T to the power Q in front of this. When you rescale T, of course, you rescale this other commutator, because that's to shorten the notation for the slide. But anyway, you rescale D, and then in this, so this is just one term in the J-Law formula, which has many terms like that. And then what you do, you move all these exponentials, all these heat operators, you move them to the end, and you move them to the end by passing over commutators of D with A. And when you look at the expansion which you get, you see that the remainder will get smaller and smaller. And not only in order, but in norm. And in fact, there is an asymptotic expansion of this form, which allows you to do what is done, for instance, in for ordinary manifolds, namely pass to a sort of classical limit. And when you do that, you can rephrase everything in terms of zeta functions, because the Mellin transform and its inverse takes you from, after you move the heat operator to the end, I mean, the Mellin transform takes it to a zeta function. And conversely, if you start with the cocycle, which I wrote here, and use sort of the inverse Mellin transform, you can see that you'll get asymptotic expansions for this kind of expressions. So this game allows to pass from the J-Law cocycle to that cocycle. And that's the algebraic part, is what Boris showed yesterday. But of course, you need a residue. So what is analytic in this manipulation is the fact that we have the assumption of zeta dimension spectrum, which means that we know that we get zeta functions which don't have singularities outside a discrete set. So with this condition, one can do this kind of passage and one obtains the local index formula. Now, if you look at what happens in the classical case, so in the classical case, you take, for instance, a Dirac operator itself, but you can take any geometric elliptic operator. It works the same. It's always a Dirac with coefficients, more or less. And so what happens in that case is that the zeta dimension spectrum on a manifold for any geometric elliptic operator is always simple. The simplest, which means that it has only simple poles. And the poles are less than in, give you the dimension not only of the manifold itself, but also show you the dimensions of the submanifolds, possible dimensions. They are integers less than n, the dimension of the manifold located at those kind of points. So, and again, the residue function is, of course, Podzinski's non-commutative residue, because that was our model for extending it. And what happens is that the formula, which I wrote on the other slide, simplifies a lot, because all the terms in which, in the sum, in which this multi-index k is not zero, this disappears, they are all zero. And so you remain only with the simple commutators and only with the residue, non-commutative residue of this expression, which can be shown to be exactly the A hat form associated to, which is built out of the Riemannian curvature of the manifold, and you recover the exact local form of the index formula. And this is all done just by Gessler's rescaling argument, just by the asymptotic calculus, symbolic calculus for asymptotic operators of Gessler, for instance. Okay, so that's an extension of the local index theorem to the spectral triples, and if you, the localization of the Chern character, but typically of how Alain is doing things. In the same paper in which we put this local index formula, you wanted to put a typical situation in which you have a spectral triple, which is also occurring in real life in geometry, the geometry of foliations. And it satisfies the basic assumptions of having a zeta dimension spectrum as we need it. So this is the geometric model for the space of leaves of a foliation. And it's modeled on, since, okay, you describe such a space by et al. Group weights associated to a transversal to the foliation, which it's a manifold M, far from being a connected manifold, because you can make it from little transversals, a union of a little transversals, which give you a complete transversal. So the algebra is more or less, it looks like convolution algebra of a cross product, or it's in fact the convolution algebra of a et al. Group weight, but it's not far from being such a cross product, which I wrote here. And so to construct a sort of elliptic operator on such a space, you have to have, which should work universally for all foliations, you have to have some diff invariant elliptic operator on this transversal on a manifold. Well, diff invariant because thinking of it as living on a transversal, of course, it has to be invariant under holonomy. Now, it cannot be an elliptic operator if you want it to cover all foliations, because if you had an elliptic operator, then its symbol would give you a metric, a Riemannian structure, diff invariant. Of course, this doesn't exist. And the foliations which have such a transverse structures are the Riemannian foliations. So it's a special class. If you want to cover all foliations, then you need another construction, a little bit more elaborate. And this is based on what Alain called the reduction to the almost isometric case, which is in the paper, Transverse Fundamental, Cyclic Cohomology and Transverse Fundamental Class. That's an extremely rich paper in ideas. Golian talked about some of the results of that paper yesterday, for instance. So in the same paper, he had this kind of construction, which amounts to take the frame bundle and divide by the action of, so the frame bundle is a GLN bundle. Well, since we work in the orientable case, I put GL plus, you divide by SON, and the quotient is a bundle whose sections are exactly the Riemannian matrix, because that's what you get by dividing GLN by SON. You get Hermitian, you get symmetric matrices, which give you exactly matrix on the tangent space at each point. So you have this vibration has a sub-bundle, which is the vertical one, the kernel of the projection. And you also have the horizontal bundle, but to get it, you need a connection. So you have to make a choice of a connection on this bundle. And then you get not a metric on the total space of this bundle itself, but you get two metrics, one in the vertical direction, two natural metrics. The metric in the vertical direction is just a typical metric on GLN modulo its maximal compact. So the Cartan-Killing form gives such a metric, for instance. This is an invariant metric vertically under GLN. And then on the normal bundle, you just take the tautological metric, because at each point of the normal bundle, I mean, it's just the fiber being identified with the tangent space, you get a metric because G itself, the point itself in P is a metric. So with these two ingredients, you can now define an operator which is not completely invariant, of course, because we chose a connection, but it's as invariant as it can possibly be. And to this operator is like taking a sort of signature operator in the vertical sub-bundle and the analog of a D plus DH star, the Ram operator in the horizontal direction. And now, because of this discrepancy between vertical and horizontal, you have to use modified pseudo-differential calculus, which was done in a more general setting of what's called Heisenberg manifolds. And using this modified pseudo-differential calculus, which sort of puts the two sides on the same footing, like it gives degree two to the horizontal direction instead of, and degree one to the vector fields in the vertical direction. So it balances off. And then you show that this operator is self-adjoint. You can take its, you can take its first order avatar by this formula. And you obtain a spectral triple exactly like in that definition, which has the zeta dimension spectrum. It has only simple poles, and the residue trace is exactly like the given by the Wozniacki residue formula, except that in his formula for the non-commutative residue, you put the symbol associated to this kind of pseudo-differential calculus, I mean. Okay, so we had this example, and then we saw that we need an afternoon to compute its Chern character with the other formula which we put in the paper. And that afternoon lasted about 3 years, and or so, maybe more. No, about 3 years, in which, of course, for a long while we didn't think of it, but eventually we realize that if you write that formula, what you see in it is, remember that it was all on the frame bundle. So you see the frame bundle has vertical vector fields, yij, and horizontal vector fields. And so now, since you work with this G, Gn is the diff group of Rn, if you work with differential operators and the cross products, this is a typical monomial in the cross product, you extend these vector fields. And when you extend them, they are no longer derivations. Well, y is, but not the x's. So if you take commutators between them, and you look at the algebra they generate, then you, because they are no longer derivations, the commutators will give you new operators, multiplication by some functions which appear, typical functions which appear in the expression of the connection or typical standard connection on the frame bundle. You get these expressions. So a little while, X is in Rn and Y is in GLn. This bold Y is a matrix. And so what you get, in fact, is a Hopf algebra, because when we write the fact that they are not derivation, you see that, okay, they still satisfy a Leibniz rule for products, and you can copy the Leibniz rule for products to get a coproduct on this algebra generated by them. And you also have an antipode. And there is also a character which comes into play, because the vertical vector fields, I mean, GLn has a trace, a natural trace. So the Lie algebra also has a differential of that. Now, there is also a canonical trace on the cross product algebra, as we all know. That's invariant with respect to the action of the Hopf algebra, which I just described over there. Invariant up to delta, so it's now this delta, we use delta for many things, but this delta is the character on Hn now. Okay, so the character which comes from the determinant of the differential of the determinant on GLn. Okay, so what you get from this picture, if you look at the formula we had for the local formula in which we had to take expressions like higher commutators with D and stuff like that, well, instead of D, you can work with Q, but Q was made of X's and Y's. So higher commutators means exactly what's in this Hopf algebra applied to the elements of the algebra. So in fact, you see that there is a sort of characteristic, something which wants to be a characteristic map from the tensor product of this Hopf algebra to the cyclic complex. This map is in fact, for each integer Q, is faithful, and it sort of enforces a tautological cyclic structure on Hn, because you just carry back, transport back the cyclic structure here on the right, you move it on the left. So what you get is a cyclic object with a basic formulas for the boundaries and degeneracies, and given by this easy to understand expressions, because they are just taking the usual expressions for an algebra and moving them to the coalgebra. However, the cyclic operator is more interesting, because it involves, if you write what it is, it involves the antipode. In fact, it involves the antipode, the convolution of the antipode with that character. And because this convoluted antipode, modified antipode, is an involution, you get a cyclic operator, indeed. And so with this, you get a cyclic structure on the Hopf algebra, and which can be computed, for instance, in the simplest case of age one, when n is one, it's the periodic cyclic cohomology can be shown to have just dimension two. So the even class is what comes from the transverse fundamental class, or the fundamental class for a space like that, the cross product. And there is something which is like the Gaudin-Weil class, and you see that more about that a little bit later. So this generates the even part, this generates the odd part of the cyclic cohomology, periodic cyclic cohomology. But there is also, since it was mentioned yesterday by Alain, there is another nice class in HC2. Periodically, it vanishes, but it's a class in it's a two cocycle, which is given, which will give, if you apply it to the cross product of functions by diffeomorphism on the frame bundle or on. Yes, you get exactly the formula for the Schwarzian. Why? Because remember the delta one, what I say delta one here, it was delta one, one of the delta ijks. So it would be like delta one, 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 because I am in dimension one. And delta one, one, one involves gamma one, 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 which is just, this is the derivative of the log of the phi prime. Phi prime is just the derivative of phi. Phi is a diffeomorphism of R. So it involves the derivative of log. And so when you take delta two, you take the second derivative of log minus one half the square of the first derivative. That's exactly the Schwarzian. Okay, so the theorem which we proved is that this Hopf algebra has in fact a structure which is naturally coming from the group of diffeomorphisms, so I'll not elaborate on that. It's a bicross product of a part which is a universal enveloping algebra. So two classical Hopf algebras, and which form a matching pair here. And the other one is functions on a sort of a pro-unipotent group, diffeomorphism which preserves the origin up toward the zero, and you just take the jet at zero there. That's a group, the group of jets at zero of such diffeomorphisms. So what we showed is that there is a canonical quasi-isomorphism from the Gelfand-Fuchs complex of the algebra of formal vector fields on Rn to this cyclic complex, and that the periodic cyclic cohomology of this Hopf algebra Hn with coefficients in this one-dimensional module C delta is given by exactly the Gelfand-Fuchs cohomology in this way, in the also in the relative case when you divide by SON. Here I put only ON, okay. So moreover, there is a canonical action of HN, as we saw on the frame bundle, and also one on the matrix bundle, and both of them have come with characteristic maps. And so you do get a map in, you can recognize the cyclic cocycle, which gives a local formula for the Chern character of this spectral triple, which I mentioned before, is falls in the range of this characteristic map. What it doesn't give you, it doesn't give you exactly the which class from the Gelfand-Fuchs cohomology is exactly involved in this. But I understand that Nigel from his abstract will talk about follow-up to write the exact expression of that Chern character. So now what is, in addition to that, in fact, you can see that this Hopf-cyclic cohomology, I mean, reaches not just that churn character, it reaches, in fact, any cyclic co-cycle which is differentiable in some sense, which I will explain a little bit. So in particular, of course, I should mention two things. One is that this is only the localization of the identity that we can reach with the Hopf algebra. So if you have a group which is acting so that at the level of the frame boundary the action is free, then it's enough. But otherwise, you only get from the Chern character, you only get the part localized at the identity. All right, now let me explain why this gives a good theory for the foliations, for the characteristic classes of foliations, which can be extended to beyond this just foliation. I should also say that Masoud will talk about the extension of the notion of cyclic complex, I mean, with coefficients in not just in a one-dimensional module like we needed here, the generalization of that and all sorts of other extensions. This should be in Masoud's talk, I understand. Okay, so now let me quickly explain this relation with characteristic classes. So there is a Bode complex, of course, for equivariant cohomology, which comes in the theory of characteristic classes. I also mentioned the first Gelfand Fuchs. And there are two Durham versions. Bode complex is a Durham version of the simplicial, of the Durham structure or Durham complex for a simplicial space, simplicial manifold. But there is another one given by DuPont. Both of them, okay, they give isomorphic cohomologies, but DuPont's complexes, both of them are graded, differentially graded complex, differential graded DG complexes, but DuPont has the advantage that it's commutative, well, graded commutative. So you can do operations in it. Okay, so they also have differentiable versions, which are not used in topology, but they are useful here. So differentiable means that you only look at, so I'm talking about the simplicial complex associated to the diff group acting on a manifold. This G script G is the diff group. If they depend, the forms depend only on a finite jet, a finite order jets up to a finite order for each of them, then this it's called differentiable. So, all right. As I said, now I'm giving you an idea about how we obtained the isomorphism of the periodic cyclic cohomology with Gelfand Fuchs in that. Namely, if you fix a connection on the frame bundle, you can extend then by taking the jet, full jet of the exponential map with respect to that connection. You can define a map from the simplicial space associated to the group acting on P of M to P infinity, which corresponds to taking the jets, I mean, and then doing in the jets what you did in the first jet. And the frame bundle is the first jet. P infinity are higher jets divided by SON. And so by integrating over the simplex, you get a map which is a quasi-isomorphism. So this map takes an element in Gelfand Fuchs complex, it moves it on an invariant, diff invariant form on the jet bundle divided by that. Then you integrate and you get this map. And that map gives you the isomorphism from here to here at the level of cyclic cohomology, the quasi-iso. What I want to say is that this map passes through the DuPont complex, in fact, here. Durham complex. So in that you can produce by chaired veil, the usual algorithm, but working on a simplicial manifold, you can produce all the classes which they have in the foliations, not only the Chern classes, but the transgressed Chern classes. And then you move them in the other complex by this. And then eventually, how do you, so you reach the equivariant cohomology described by Bott like this, but how do you get into the cyclic cohomology? Well, for that you have to use Kohn's map phi. That's a famous, infamous map because it's complicated to write, but it's, I explained in some other talk why it is a natural kind of map. It's the character of over a differential graded algebra, in fact. So with that map, if you follow what I said with that map, you do get the isomorphism explained in the theorem between Gelfand-Fuchs cohomology or the cohomology of the equivariant cohomology in the Bott complex to periodic cyclic cohomology of the Hopf algebra. Okay, this all can be extended not just to the Hopf algebra AGM, but for any geometry, as in Eric Cartan's classification, you have a pseudo group, you have a Lie algebra, infinite dimension Lie algebra, you can associate a Hopf algebra. And this is in some papers with Bahram Rangipur, that to each primitive Lie pseudo group, we have a bicross product Hopf algebra associated to that. There is again an isomorphism of the cyclic cohomology of that with the Lie algebra cohomology of Gelfand-Fuchs for the corresponding Lie subalgebra. And what else? And there are also relative versions of that. So this all can be extended to all kinds of, to all the classical geometries and all kinds of foliations equipped with extra structures. Now, Sasha Gorohovsky found sort of more commutative but simpler looking way of describing characteristic classes of foliations, if you want, by taking the Hopf algebra coming from forms on GLN, not just functions on GLN. You take all forms, the Durham complex on GLN. So it's like a tensor product of a finite dimension exterior algebra with functions. So it has a structure of a Fréchet Hopf algebra. He associated the cyclic complex to it, differential graded Hopf algebra has a corresponding differential graded cyclic cohomology. And there are lots of truncations which can be defined by the degree. So if you take the corresponding truncation for each level F, M, cut off the degree to a level, then you get another theory. And he showed, Sasha showed that the cyclic cohomology of these truncations are exactly the same with Gelfand-Fuchs, or if you want, with the cohomology of the V algebras, classically known. And the main steps in proving such a thing is that the Hochschild complex of this Hopf algebra is exactly the simplicial Durham complex of the NERV of GLN, or the simplicial manifold of GLN. It's exactly that. And you just have to use Van Est in addition to that. That's not so clear from Sasha's paper, but it's clear from a paper of Bott, which is called On the Chern-Weil Theory for Chern-Weil, yes, the theory for a Lie group or something, a beautiful paper. Anyway, that Hopf algebra, just by acts on forms on a manifold, of course, and the action is given by the first jet, taking only the first jet of a diffeomorphism. So if you have, what I mean is that if you have a group, discrete group acting on a manifold, this gives you a groupoid. If you take the product, the cross product, and then you get an action of the Hopf algebra of GLN on the forms over the group wages by this simple formula. You multiply by the pullback of the first jet of a form from GLN. It has a closed graded trace, this algebra. So you do get, again, this action satisfies the condition to have a characteristic map. You do get a characteristic map. This is like our characteristic map in the case of the other Hopf algebra, but it's DG version. And by means of this, you can show that, in fact, this is what I sketch in another talk, the cyclic homology, periodic cyclic of HN mod ON is isomorphic to the periodic homology of this algebra, truncated at exactly the dimension n. But looking at this result, you see that here you have the relative thing, here you don't have the relative thing. Where is the, in our in what I explained about this algebra HN, we also had a version of the cyclic homology of HN, not divided by ON, with coefficients in C delta. And you can also take the relative cohomology with respect to GLN. So it's rather strange a little bit here that here you have relative, here it looks absolute. What are the relative version of Sasha's corresponding cohomologies? Well, it turns out that the relative versions, they are all related to Van Est type theorem. So in each case, you can alter a little bit the definition of the Hopf algebra. One way to do this, you just take the germs at the unit at one. So you divide by, it's like Alexander Spanier in a way. You define by a subcomplex, which is zero if one of this is equal to one.
I'm afraid we are already a little bit over time. So
okay, let me take just one more minute. So you can form the germ algebra by taking the quotient, or you can form the algebraic complex by taking, well, here I sketched how you compute the cohomology of the germ algebra and how you compute the cohomology of the algebraic algebra. So there are two other versions. One is the algebraic version of Hopf algebra. The other one is the germ one. Each of them gives you, one of them gives you the relative mod GLN, namely the algebraic one, and the other one gives you the absolute. I mean, the germ one gives you the absolute thing. Now, everything is seen clearly in dimension one. The basis for the germ one is G inverse. G is just X, because if you want GL plus, I put G because it works for GLN also, but taking traces. So you get the two generators of the cohomology in the case of germs. You see, they are germs because here you get logarithm and this one. So omega two is of one is zero. The other one is also D one is zero. And for the absolute one, to get the absolute cohomology, to get the cohomology mod GL1, you have to take the algebraic complex. Now, Gordbion Vey is this delta one, which we had. It has a lot of avatars, but it also has a modular avatar. I don't have time to explain it, but what we showed in another paper with Alain was that the Hopf algebra H1 acts on modular Hecke algebras. And it acts because the derivative of a modular form is not a modular form. So it has to be corrected by a connection. This is Ramanujan's formula. And with that, you get an action which takes your classes, basic classes, of the periodic cohomology of GL of H1 into interesting entities for the these modular Hecke algebras. In particular, you get a nice form, rational expression of the Euler class, of course, rational because it's the Euler class of GL2Q plus in terms of Dedekind sums. That would be the. So I end with this application, just mentioning it, just to show you that the theory of characteristic classes as encoded in this universal receptacle or repository of a Hopf algebra would work in other contexts, not just foliations, but you know, these are basic objects, like for instance, GLN. GLN acts in many other places, not just as a principal bundle. And you can move the characteristic classes obtained from this Hopf-cyclic cohomology and its DG version, you can move them to lots of other places which are inaccessible by the classical theories. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Henri, thank you. Okay, I just want to say one thing before I ask about questions, which is that we should relax about time. Let me explain why. Because this afternoon, there will be a gap between the talk of Max Karubi and the next talk, which is